And we welcome back to the show author, blogger, mother of five, pastor's wife, and reality TV personality, Jen Hatmaker, as if all of the above wasn't enough, right?
Oh, my goodness. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's great to have you back.
Thank you.
I want to talk a little bit about the big issue that so many women face. You see it there. We're surrounded by invitations to perfection. Mm. And how does one find balance?
Isn't that a great question? And I just don't have time for any of that nonsense, that perfect ideal anymore. People ask me all the time, Jen, you just do this and this and this, and how do you balance it all? And I'm here to tell you, I don't even think that's real. I think balance is not even achievable. I think we've invented this idea that some of us are nailing it and some of us are not. I think it's seasonal, because balance implies it's all the same. Mm-hmm. Everything's weighted equally, and that's never true.
Yeah,
and so I am getting very comfortable with the word no. Yeah. I am getting very comfortable with the phrase, I cannot do that right now. Mm-hmm. And I'm also learning how to set aside all the guilt that used to come with that.
And that's what you do in your book. You give permission to the rest of us to join you on that journey of freedom.
I really do. In For the Love, I have an essay called On the Beam. And I use this metaphor. Some things just do not belong on the beam. Some things go off the beam. And women particularly, I think we struggle with this more than men. I'm not sure, but I think we have this mechanism that says, I should always say yes, I should always be agreeable, and I should always be amazing all the time. And I think it's really ruining us on the inside. And so I am here to tell you, no, ma'am. Yeah. Off the beam it goes, and we're going to live in freedom.
And you're very candid about the fact that you've done that in your own life. I mean, I kind of chuckled when you, as a pastor's wife, freely, because of the other things that God has in your life right now, say, I can't do that study right now. I can't belong to that group right now. I mean, we need to know when enough is enough and when good enough is enough.
That's right. I hope that sets a lot of people free. My husband is the lead pastor of our church, and there are so many really beautiful and wonderful and good church things that I say no to, that I cannot participate in, because we cannot do it all. That's the message. I mean, this is not a book to tell women how to do it all. It's a book to say, you can't do it all, and that's okay, and you are already doing amazing in the spaces that you're in. So I hope it's liberating.
And you talk about giving ourselves some grace. You know, I think we all try to do that anyway with our spouses, with our children, with friends. But you say sometimes we need to give grace to ourselves, and you can't earn that. It's unmerited, isn't it?
I think that's where it begins. And I think when it comes, you know, we're sort of a grace-starved culture right now. All you have to do is look around and see how people are just lonely and they are hurting and we're isolating one another. Mm-hmm. And I think this is an inside job. When we are able to receive grace for ourselves, I find that we are so much better able to give it away. And so I always tell women, let's start with you. You have grace. You don't have to earn it. You don't have to be good enough for it. It's a free gift. Mm-hmm. And so our biggest job is to learn how to receive it.
Yeah. You have a chapter in the book called Dear Church. You know, church is probably one of the places where we most want to contribute something and sometimes can feel the most pressure to measure up to something. So talk a little bit about how we as church people can have grace and extend grace, because that's where it should begin, isn't it?
I'm a lifer in church, pastor's daughter, pastor's wife. I love the local church and believe in her. Mm-hmm. And so one thing that I know experientially is that there's no better place to hide than the church. I mean, you can get in there. I know all the language. I know all the rules.
You know all the songs.
I know all the songs. I know the alto version of all the songs. And so I'm so hopeful for the church if we will learn as a community to be transparent and truthful. It is absolutely transformative. I have seen it, and for me, I believe it starts top down. I would love to see our pastors have the courage and the bravery to stand in front of us and say, this is what's true about me.
Yeah.
This is where I'm struggling. This is what I've struggled with in the past, and God has helped me overcome. Honesty and vulnerability is incredibly powerful. And I think once we set that loose in our churches and we stop hiding from one another, I believe we'll see God's kingdom come in our generation.
I couldn't agree with you more. I see that in my own church. I have a pastor that does that. And you know, it draws people. It draws people because we're all coming together in our brokenness to love each other, grow, and move forward. And it's a good thing.
It is a good thing. And I think that's what people misunderstand. What seems to be the very scariest thing, which is to tell the truth, is actually the thing that draws people to you. It doesn't push you away. When you say something true to me, I'm not afraid of you. I'm not going to hide from you.
Yeah.
You'll
don't
be the first
to.
Person
yeah.
I come to.
Exactly.
And so what a powerful message to send among believers.
Mm-hmm. You say that with the reality show that you did, I can't even imagine doing a reality show with my family. It's terrifying.
It was terrifying.
But you said that the experience caused you to set stricter boundaries for your family. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, let me explain. The show actually, in a strange paradox, ended up being so good for our family. It was so much togetherness, and it was so much time working alongside with each other. And so at the end of the show, when we had just really come together, we said, we need more of this.
Yeah.
We didn't realize how much we had let that fall until we were sort of forced into such close proximity. And so at the end of the show, we said, okay, that's it. We need to protect our family time better. And mm-hmm. so we set tighter boundaries around our evenings. We sit around our dinner table and have dinner together almost every night of the week,
nice.
Which means we say no to a lot mm-hmm. of other things. We tell our kids now, no phones in the morning. Morning, we're going to have conversation. We're going to look each other in the eye. We are going to speak mm-hmm. words to each other. And so it seems that seems radical in today's phone culture.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a bunch of teenagers. They all have phones. I want to throw their phones against the wall sometimes. And so we just said, this is worth protecting.
Yeah.
And we will say no when everybody else is saying yes, if that mm-hmm. makes it more accessible to our family.
Yeah. There's so much wise counsel in Jen's book, and I just want to highly recommend it to you, because in addition to the wise counsel is an inordinate amount of laughter. It is such a fun read, but it's also very thought-provoking. If you'd like to get a copy of her new book, it's called For the Love. It's available wherever books are sold, and I highly, highly recommend it. Great to have you back.
Thank you, Terry. Always
Thank
good
you.
To see you.
Anxious to see what you do next.
Thank you.